Hi guys! This week for Language Arts, we are going to read chapters 9 and 10. And then after we read chapter 10, we're going to take a quiz. It's going to be pretty similar to last chapters 1 through 5 quiz. So basically, we're still looking at parts of speech and we're climbing up that plot mountain. So we're pretty much just looking for rising action pieces. So Chapter 9 is where we'll start at today. For your notes, I just want you to focus on pretty much the same things as last week, but we did one day, we did adjectives describing melody, and then, so because adjectives are describing words, and then we did verbs, specifically anything that melody can do or can do for the first time. While I read chapter 9, I want you to focus on both of those things. So, describing melody, which is adjectives, and verbs, things that she can do or start to do. And these will be in your notes. So, I have made new notes for chapters 9 and chapter 10. And so, I outlined that for you. And that's about it. So, once again, pause the video whenever you need to pause, rewatch the video. Or email me with any questions. I'm gonna get started. Usually, so we're at chapter 9. Usually, our bold words are about a paragraph. The bold words on this page is just one sentence. So the bold words say, when I was 8, comma, things changed. So I think I knew mom was going to have a baby even before she did. She smelled different, like new soap. Her skin felt softer and warmer. She picked me up out of bed one morning, then almost let me fall back on the mattress. "Whoo," she said, "you're getting awfully heavy, Melody. I'm going to have to start lifting weights." So just to get back in the groove of things, mom just called Melody heavy. So that is going to be an adjective. So, Melody has been described as heavy. Okay. Her forehead had broken out in a sweat. I don't think I'd gained any weight. It was mom who was different. She sat down on the chair next to my bed for a few minutes, then suddenly ran out of the room. I heard her throwing up in the bathroom. She came back a few minutes later looking pale. Her breath smelled like mouthwash. "I must have eaten something funky," she mumbled as she got me dressed. But I think she knew even then. I bet she was scared. When mom finally figured it out, she sat down with me to break the news. "Melody, I have something wonderful to tell you." I did my best to look curious. "You're going to have a baby brother or sister real soon." I grinned and did my best imitation of surprise and excitement. I reached out and hugged her. Then I patted her stomach and pointed to myself. She knew what I meant. She looked me right in the eye. "We're gonna pray that this little one is fat and fine and healthy," she told me. "You know we love you, Melody, just as you are, but we're hoping this child doesn't have to face the challenges that you do." Me too. From then on, she put Dad in charge of lifting me, and although she never talked about it again in front of me, I knew she was worried. She gobbled gigantic green vitamin pills, ate lots of fresh oranges and apples, and she had this habit of touching her bulging belly and mumbling a prayer. I could tell that Dad was scared too, but his worry showed up in funny little ways, like bringing mom piles of purple irises, her favorite flower, or fixing her gallons of grape Kool-Aid, or big plates of grapes. I don't know what made mom crave purple stuff. Instead of watching hours and hours of the Discovery Channel, I found myself in my room staring at an empty TV screen, just thinking in silence. So, something that Melody's doing, and it is something new, is she's just staring. So, even though it's an action word, she's not doing much, but she's just staring at an empty TV screen. So, you can write that down as a verb. Did I say verb? I don't know. Sorry. So, write it down as a verb. She's staring at an empty TV screen. Okay. I knew that a new baby was really time-consuming, and I also knew I took up a lot of time. How would my parents ever have time for both of us? Then a really horrible thought popped into my brain. What if they decided to look into Dr. Hughley's suggestions? I couldn't make the thought go away. One Saturday afternoon, a few months before the baby was born, I was curled up on our sofa, dozing. Mom had put pillows around me to make sure I didn't fall off. Butterscotch slept nearby, and Dad's favorite jazz station played a saxophone snoozer. Mom and Dad sat together on the smaller sofa, talking together quietly. I'm sure they thought I was asleep. What if, Mom said, her voice tight. It won't be. The chances are so small, honey, Dad replied, but he sounded unsure. I couldn't bear it, Mom told him. You'd find the strength, he said calmly, but it's not going to happen. The odds are, but what if, she insisted, interrupting him, and for only the second time I could remember, my mother started to cry. Everything is gonna be fine, my father said, trying to soothe her. We've got to think positive thoughts. It's all because of me, my mother said softly. I perked up and listened harder. What do you mean? Dad said. It's my fault that Melody is like she is. Mom was crying really hard then. I could hardly make out her words. Diane, that's crazy. You can't hold on to that kind of guilt. These things just happen. I could tell Dad was trying to be reasonable. No, I'm the mother, she wailed. It is my job to bring a child into the world safely, and I screwed it up. Every other woman on this planet is able to give birth to a normal baby. There must be something wrong with me. Sweetheart, it's not your fault. It's not your fault. And I could hear him pull my mom to him. But Chuck, I'm so scared. This baby is going to be messed up too, she said in a shuddering breath. Please don't go there. Don't even think like that, Dad murmured. Statistically, what are the chances? Two children who. And I suddenly couldn't hear him anymore because my head was pulsing with the things I wanted to say, but I couldn't. I wanted to tell Mom that I was sorry. She was so sad and so scared, that it wasn't her fault, that I was just the way I was, and that she had nothing to do with it. The part that hurt the most is I couldn't tell her any of it. During Mom's entire pregnancy, however, my parents' attention to me never wavered. Even though, yeah, I worried that it would. Dad did lots more as Mom got closer to her due date. He did some of the laundry, most of the cooking, and all the lifting and carrying. I got to school on time every day, got my stories read to me every night, and the three of us waited and hoped and prayed. But Penny was born perfect and copper bright, just like her name. From the minute she came home from the hospital, she was a really happy baby. Mom truly did carry a little bundle of joy into the house. But I guess a new baby is rough on any parent, especially if they already have a kid like me at home. Sometimes there would be arguments. I could hear them through the bedroom wall. I need more help around here, Chuck, Mom would say, trying to keep her voice low. Well, you pay more attention to the baby than you do to me. If you'd help more, I'd have more time for you with two kids and one of them. Melody, it's not easy. I have to go to work, you know. I have a job too. Don't throw that in my face. Plus, I'm up twice a night to nurse the baby. I know, I'm sorry, Diane. Dad always softened and let Mom win. It's just I'm so tired all the time, Mom would say, her voice muffled. I'm sorry, I'll do better. I promise. I'll take off work tomorrow and take care of both work girls. Why don't you go catch a movie or take Mrs. Valencia out to lunch? It would get quiet once more, but even so, somehow, I always ended up feeling a tiny bit guilty. Life sure would be easier if they had only one child, one with working parts. I once got one of those electronic dolls for Christmas. It was supposed to talk and cry and move its arms and legs if you push the right buttons. But when we opened the box, one of the arms had come off, and all the doll did, no matter which button you pushed, was squeak. Mom took it back to the store and got her money back. I wonder if she ever wished she could go get a refund for me. But Penny really was a perfect baby. After just a few months, she was sleeping through the night and smiling through each day. She sat up exactly when infants are supposed to, rolled over right on schedule, and crawled on cue. Amazing, and it seemed so easy. Sure, she fell on her face a few times, but once she got it, she was off. Penny zoomed around like a little wind-up toy. She learned that the toilet was fun to splash in and that the lamps will fall if you grab the cord. She learned that golden retrievers are not ponies, peas taste funny, dead flies on the floor are a no-no, but candy is really good. She laughed all the time. She learned her sister Melody couldn't do what she could do, but she didn't seem to care. So I tried not to care either. Dad and his camcorder followed Penny around like the paparazzi. Follow a rock star. We have hundreds of hours of footage of Penny being cute and doing adorable things. And well, I admit it, I got kind of sick of watching a new video every time she learned something new. It sort of sucks to watch a baby do what you wish you could do. Penny holding her own bottle. Penny feeding herself teeny tiny Cheerios from her high chair tray. Penny saying mama and dada, just like the babies on Sesame Street. Penny crawling on the floor and chasing butterscotch. Penny clapping her hands. How did her little brain know how to tell her to pull herself up to a standing position, to hold on to the sofa for balance? How did she know how to stand on her own? Sometimes she'd fall over, but then she'd pop right back up. Never ever did she lie there, stuck like a turtle in its shell. Dad still did our nighttime reading, but now it was Penny who snuggled up on his lap. I was too big and too hard to balance, so I sat in my wheelchair, my dog at my feet, as the two of them read the stories I knew by heart. Butterscotch still slept only in my room. I liked that. It really did make me glad to know Penny was learning the same books I loved so much. I wondered if she was memorizing them. Probably not. She didn't need to. I think Penny's third word was Dee Dee. She couldn't quite say Melody, but she got the last part. I loved it when Mom put Penny in bed with me after her morning bath. She'd grab me and plant wet baby powder smelling kisses all over my face. Dee Dee, she'd say again and again. By the time she was 1 year old, Penny could walk. She wobbled all over the house on her fat little legs. She fell a lot, dropping down on her butt and laughing every time she did. Then she'd get back up and try it again. That was something I'd never get to try. With two kids in the house, our family routines changed. It took twice as long to get everybody ready each morning. Mom made sure Penny was dressed in pretty little outfits every day, even though she was just going next door to Mrs. V's house. My clothes were okay, but I was noticing that lately they were more useful than cute. Mom seemed to be choosing them by how easy they'd be to get on. Mom seemed to be choosing them by how easy they'd be to get on me. It was kind of a bummer, but I knew I was getting heavier and heavier to lift, and so changing me was harder. I probably should mention that feeding me is a real process. I can't chew very well, so I'm mostly getting soft foods like scrambled eggs or oatmeal or applesauce. Since I can't hold a fork or spoon, I try, but I keep dropping them. Okay, so for an action, we can say that she drops forks or spoons. And we'll keep reading and see. Someone has to place the food into my mouth one spoonful at a time. It's slow. Spoon, slurp, swallow. Spoon, slurp, swallow. So those are actions too, right? She's slurping, she's swallowing. Lots of food falls on the floor. Butterscotch likes that. She's like a canine vacuum cleaner. Drinking stuff is hard for me too. I can't hold a glass and I can't sip from a straw. So somebody has to very carefully hold a cup to my lips and tip a little bit of liquid into my mouth so I can swallow. Too much and I choke and cough. And we have to start all over. It takes a long time to get a meal in me. I hate the whole process, obviously. And some mornings were really stressful. Chuck, can you bring me Melody's pink t-shirt from the clean clothes basket? She spilled juice all over her shirt. Mom yelled up the stairs. Didn't you put a bib on her, Diane? Dad yelled back. You know she makes a mess. Why don't you wait and dress her after she eats? So you want me to feed her naked? Just bring the shirt, Mom snapped. And a diaper for Penny. She's got a stinker. She's two. Isn't she old enough to be potty trained? Dad asked, coming downstairs with the blue t-shirt I had outgrown in one hand and a diaper in the other. Right, I'll get to potty training tonight on the 25th hour of my day. Dad picked up Penny up. Uh-oh, that's a bad one, he said, his nose scrunched up. Did you give her sweet potatoes again last night? I thought we stopped giving her those because they always give her the runs. Well, if you had gone to the grocery store like I asked, I could have given her something different. And that shirt is blue, not pink, and too small for Melody. Mom stormed out of the kitchen and up the stairs. Sorry, girls, Dad said to us. He whistled softly while he cleaned Penny up, threatening to call the hazmat team. That was funny. Then he finished feeding me breakfast, not caring that my oatmeal was getting all over the juice-stained shirt. Why not? May as well make a real mess and make it worth all the stress, he said with a laugh. I smiled at him and smeared my oatmeal on my tray. Mom came back down with fresh makeup and a freshly painted-on smile, her hair done, and with my pink shirt. She and Dad hugged in the kitchen, both took a deep breath, and we actually made it out of the house on time. We had lots of days like that. All right, that's the end of chapter 9. So we have a new character, Penny, little sister, and let's put it as our second rising action, although that chapter wasn't very exciting, but it's something new in the story, right? And I think that's why chapter 9 had just one sentence as bold, because it was really talking about, like, this is important. I have a sister now, right? So that's going to be our second rising action. And then we had some adjectives and verbs, although I don't think I'm going to do that for chapter 10 because there's really not that much. And watch now, chapter 10, probably going to have a lot of those, but that's okay. So just write down, you should have just wrote down the adjectives and verbs, mostly the ones that I mentioned. And then second rising action, our new character, Penny, is the younger sibling. And so just something to think about is, and you don't have to write this down, but if we were in class, you know, we would be having discussion. So, do you think that Penny is gonna become the center of attention? Do you think maybe it'll push Melody to learn new things with her? Because at this point, Penny can already do more things than Melody can. So, is this going to push Melody into doing more things, or is it maybe going to put Melody on the back burner and they're going to focus on Penny since they know she can do all these things? Are they going to be focused on that and less focused on Melody really getting the most out of life that she can? So, just a few things to think about. You'll have chapter 10, I'll upload that, and then we'll have a quiz on chapters 6 through 10. So, hope you have a wonderful rest of your day.